the Dr. Rice with Wapaka Chiropractic Center here in town, down on the west end of town. And I've been doing these talks most months over the last couple of years. Today's topic is arthritis, and that was brought up at our last get-together, saying, you know, this is a information that maybe we haven't touched on real specifically. So let's just review some arthritis basics, understanding what it is, common causes, how you can influence it. So first of all, what is arthritis? Common element in all forms of arthritis is that inflammation and swelling that's developing in joint spaces. And the primary issue is the cartilage that coats those bony ends starts to break down. And it perpetuates this pattern of it gets inflamed and irritated, the tissues are damaged, creates more inflammation. It becomes that vicious cycle. And pretty soon that joint becomes a bit deformed. And again, it continues to perpetuate that. And soon there's this loss of function. So probably the most common factors are 65 and older, and some sites say 55 and older. And certainly I see arthritic type signs relatively early in life in my practice. I mean, people in their 20s and 30s, we're gonna see some of those early signs. And that's when we have to start being proactive about it. But no matter what phase you're at, there are things you can do to help it. It usually occurs, you know, gradually. The most common form, this osteoarthritis, occurs gradually from various causes. We'll get to that. But according to the CDC, so Center of Disease Control, it occurs more commonly in women and more commonly those who are overweight. And those are factors because women tend not to be quite as physically active and strong as men. So unexpected injuries and wear and tear happens more readily. And unfortunately, overweight means just greater weight bearing on those joints, and they're more prone to become irritated. We don't need this. So, basic joint anatomy 101. Majority of joint structures involve those basic components. Two bony ends coming together. So easy to imagine that at knees and fingers and elbows. The cartilage coating over those surfaces that are at the connection. So we all have seen chicken bones when we're cleaning a fresh chicken, that nice, glisteny, smooth cartilage surface. That's what it should look like in a healthy joint. The joint capsule is the tissue that surrounds that joint, all around that knee, all around a finger. It encloses it. It's a closed system. And then there's synovial fluid within that system, within that joint space to lubricate that cartilage, provide nutrients and oxygen, and get rid of waste products. Helps with that process. And then around the joint capsule are the ligaments. Our ligaments hold us together, our bone structures together. Okay. So, two bony ends. Nice, smooth cartilage that coats it so it glides with this synovial fluid in between to help lubricate and allow it to move. So the synovial membrane attaches between those bony ends to create this closed capsule to hold that fluid in there. And then our ligaments are outside of that to stabilize and hold the bone structure together. Okay, so that's the basic healthy joint. What we see change in arthritis is that cartilage starts aging. Whether it's from a direct injury, impact, compression, unexpected jolt, jar, what have you, where the cartilage is actually damaged and has to repair and creates the process. Maybe an infection in the area, and bacteria or viral components eat away at that cartilage and break it down and irritates all of those internal tissues. And that synovial fluid will keep trying to lubricate it and help, etc., but it creates swelling. It's drawing fluid to that joint, saying, oh, we need to repair this. We need extra oxygen, nutrients, etc., but It also creates a lot of waste product as it's trying to repair that, which is irritating to the tissues. And it becomes, again, this vicious cycle. So controlling the swelling in that joint is imperative to reduce further damage, irritation, break the cycle. As this is swelling, those ligaments that are intended to shore that joint up nice and snug, they're being overstretched. And I know we've talked about the difference between ligament and muscle is comparing taffy to a rubber band. Ligaments are like taffy. They're strong, they're pretty stable, but once you stretch them, they really don't have the ability to come back to their original state. They will remain a bit overstretched. And certainly if there's tears, scar tissue comes in there, it becomes less elastic, less pliable. So that's where that instability of the joint continues to progress as well. So then our body has to make some other changes to try and stabilize a joint that's gotten sloppy. It no longer is held in a nice, snug, stable position. So, most common forms of arthritis, absolutely. The most common is osteoarthritis, generic, wear and tear. We'll get to some details. Rheumatoid, certainly we hear about a fair amount. That's related more to autoimmune disorders. Again, we'll talk a little bit more about that. And that's the one where we see the greater deformity, especially in hands, feet, ankles, etc. Infectious arthritis actually happens a fair bit, and similar to, again, an impact or injury that causes arthritis. That tends to happen at a single joint, where, say you have a nasty cut near a joint, and it actually breaks through some of that ligament and synovial fluid and that bacteria in there. Then a joint can become irritated, damaged because of an infective agent. There are probably hundreds, certainly 100, up to 200 different arthritis. We don't need to talk about all of them. They all kind of follow a very similar pattern, and osteoarthritis is by far the most common. They simply all affect the joint complex. So, osteoarthritis, most common form, typically occurs, again, gradually due to overuse or repetitive use. That's the most common cause. And we are such creatures of habit. We do things the same way over and over again, whether we're aware of it or not. And we use the same joint a lot for whatever tasks we do around the house, around the yard, certainly in work conditions. So damage to that cartilage, that smooth surface, wear, aging, dehydration, all cause, again, a breakdown and irritation of the cartilage, which in turn causes inflammation, swelling within that synovial capsule, and those adjacent ligaments. So they are, again, being overstretched. They can't stabilize. And it creates that pattern. Swelling, stiffness, pain, immobility. More swelling, more stiffness. So we need to try and break that pattern. So again, most common sites for osteoarthritis. Spine, hip, hands, knees, feet. Again, the places where we tend to do repetitive movement are going to show those signs first. And again, that nice, healthy-looking joint, smooth cartilage, space within that synovial region versus, again, this dry, aged, chipped, pitted cartilage that's inherent to an arthritic change. So rheumatoid arthritis, that's kind of a very separate kind of entity because it's related to these autoimmune disorders, a disease process where your body, for whatever reason, does not recognize your own tissue and starts attacking it, destroying those cells. And that's a whole kind of another conversation about what type of triggers might set that off. Because very often, many of us may have the RA factor if they did a blood test on us, but it hasn't really developed. And for most people, there's some type of triggering event, episode, pattern that sets it off and it starts doing that damage. And unfortunately, often does some very significant damage to joints that creates that cellular breakdown again. typically progresses much faster, more intensely than your typical osteoarthritis. Again, we've seen people, unfortunately, who deal with the very distorted hands, feet, ankles. Very often they're doing surgeries to simply fuse joints to reduce pain and obstruction. And rheumatoid tends to hit the limbs, knees, ankles, shoulder, elbow, wrists. And again, we see hands because they're out and available to be seen so often. So again, and usually it affects joints symmetrically, both hands, both feet, etc. And most of us don't wish that on anyone we know, indeed. Infectious arthritis, usually there's some kind of obvious illness or an injury that precedes that development of arthritis, that you know you had something happen and that joint was affected. There's inflammation, swelling, maybe fever, etc., tenderness at a specific joint. So that's when those tissues are damaged and it creates that pattern again. Inflammation, irritation, breakdown of cellular tissue. The vicious cycle begins. So indeed, say a knee and you have a direct trauma to that knee where the cartilage is impacted and is damaged internally. But that process is when you start that effort to repair, create some irritation, etc. So in this one, most common, heel, knee, hip, shoulder, because they're very prone to getting bumped, bruised, irritated, cut, etc. And be prone to those infectious events.
That's not symmetrical.
Correct. Not unless you drop on both knees or somehow hit both shoulders. Yeah, typically infectious is a single joint is being affected. So what factors influence onset? Certainly there's a genetic component, I think, for all arthritic patterns. Again, you know if your family members are dealing with that, but RA certainly has a very strong genetic component. Occupations that involve prolonged or repetitive activity. Unfortunately, that's the nature of a lot of jobs where you're using the same joint over and over and over, bending, twisting, reaching, pulling, etc. So those joints are prone to that wear and tear and damage to that cartilage. Certainly involvement in sports, and I see that all the time. Oh, and really didn't do anything, but oh yeah, I played sports in high school. I was getting knocked around all the time as a kid, did heavy lifting on a farm as a kid, those kinds of things, and we don't think about it a whole lot until 20, 30 years later you realize, oh yeah, that's right, I did have a pretty good fall, really had to have a pretty good jolt, and that's where we're at. Certainly infections that are not taken care of efficiently, so take care of those events, certainly for your family and friends, let them, you know, beware that indeed, an infection can go into a joint and result in arthritis later on. Certainly the unexpected, that's probably as common as anything with arthritis, is the unexpected trip, fall, injury that affects those joints. And who knows, again, what other triggers, and certainly we're going to get to some dietary issues that might be part of it. So let's focus on OA. Osteoarthritis, because that is the most common form we see. 27 million Americans or more have some type of osteoarthritis somewhere in their body. It really follows a pretty similar pattern all the time. The cartilage wears down, dries up, chips, frays, pitted, etc. from use and abuse. And as that cushion deteriorates, your body's response is, oh, we have to heal this tissue. We have to bring in the reinforcements. But that creates swelling within that joint space. That chronic swelling of that joint now stretches the synovial capsule, the ligaments that provide stability to that joint. Then in an effort to stabilize a joint that's become sloppy, your body says, oh, we'll just create some extra bone structure around there. And it will put those bone minerals along the edges of the joint, along ligament fibers, along muscle tendon fibers, all in the effort to say, okay, this joint is stable again, or as close as we can get. But in turn, that creates irritation and a discomfort and pain and swelling on its own. So again, part of this vicious cycle. If given enough time, a joint will self-fuse. It will join those two ends together and say, there, now it's stable. Now it won't hurt so much. And it probably won't, because it's not moving at all. You're losing function, and you're losing some other elements of that structure, but it probably doesn't hurt as much. I brought along this model that shows the progression of the spine, but it's the same true no matter what joint we're dealing with. Again, a very healthy joint with lots of space between the two bony ends. And then there's the synovial capsule and the ligaments along the side, holding those two components together. Initially, that space starts thinning. In the spine, there's a disc as well that starts thinning. But in any joint, again, there's less fluid, the cartilage starts to age, it starts breaking down. Pretty soon, the bone structures start flaring those edges, saying, we need to create a bridge from one side to the next to stabilize that. And ultimately, that may happen, where those bony spurs create enough of a structure that they attach one side to the next. The problem is, during that progression, there is a lot of pain because of swelling, irritation, and this whole progression it has to go through. So, what do you do? Certainly, if you're noticing early signs of a joint that's getting stiff and sore, be proactive as much as you can early on. But no matter what phase you're dealing with as far as arthritis, always, if there is a flare-up, follow that RICE protocol. Rest it, ice it, use a compression if that's possible, elevate it to help with that swelling inflammation, get it above heart level if that's appropriate for the area. Certainly using some kind of regular stretch and strength routine is good defense. Everyone thinks, I'll just let it rest. It'll be better if I don't use it. And to some degree, that swelling can be eased and pain will be eased, but lack of use of those surrounding tissues creates more instability. You have to use the surrounding tissues that are strong and stable to help stabilize those that aren't. So certainly doing some of the regular exercise routines they offer here and in other parts of the community, well worth it. Work that joint as much as it will allow safely. You have to be a good sensor of what's the fine line, of course. Don't push it too hard, but give it regular exercise. Certainly using a supportive wrap, knee brace, back brace, it's a little wrist wrap. That's a good idea. Again, if you have a joint that's stiff and sore and achy, and now it's feeling pretty good, put something on to support that joint so you don't re-irritate it. Something, again, very simple to strap on and help stabilize a joint that's feeling less than ideal.
You don't want to immobilize it, though.
No, but you don't want to overuse it. Right, you don't want to immobilize it. However, while you're doing an active task, you know, having it on snug so it really does stabilize that joint beyond, you know, its very limited motion during that activity, that's a safe thing to do. So you don't, again, overstretch those tissues any further. Certainly chiropractic adjustments will help with that alignment and that tissue healing in a joint that's dealing with that kind of stress. I'm always going to tell people, really avoid applying heat followed by inactivity. So I don't have a problem with heat being applied and then doing some movement. But taking that hot bath and going to bed, probably is not a good idea. Because that heat might feel good, but it is really drawing extra fluid to that irritated joint. And now you're gonna lay still for 6 to 8 hours, hopefully. And that joint's gonna get swollen and swollen because you're not moving it. It's the movement that helps it pump that fluid back into circulation. So if you're going to apply heat, go ahead and do some gentle motion. Instead, yeah, take advantage of warming up those joints. Move them afterwards to help pump that fluid out of that region. Certainly applying a cool compress, that doesn't have to be ice cold necessarily, cool, before bed, using some of those cooling gels, Biofreeze and such, on those joints before bed. So you reduce some of that swelling early on and through the night is a good idea. So again, gentle fitness, supports, cooling products, all good options. Then there's the diet issue. Choosing foods and beverages that do not promote inflammation, huge factor in influencing that pain and swelling pattern. So you focus on lots of vegetables in your diet, especially the greens. All those lettuces and such that are available this time of year, take advantage of that. Some fruits, again, fruits have sugars which increase inflammation, so you don't want to overdo it on the fruits. And that's hard to do this time of year when there's some wonderful fruit out there in the next few months. Good protein sources, you know, the lean meats and fish and chicken, etc. Some nuts and seeds are good if your body tolerates those. Lots of water. Keep flushing that system. Help your kidneys deal with that fluid and swelling and inflammation patterning. Which means trying to limit grains. And that's a tough one. And that's, I have a handout here about grains being inflammatory. Again, this is a concept that's really been promoted in the last 5 to 10 years, maybe. That whole paleo diet issue has come up. But there's absolutely some truth to that. You know, our diet has certainly changed in the last 50 years, certainly 100 years. So watch those bread, cereals, pastas. They're all around us. Try and reduce some of that. Dairy products to some degree as well, I think, tend to be inflammatory. Some of the hard cheeses, you know, some yogurt, things like that, it's okay. It's, you know, everything in moderation. But if you are a milk drinker on a regular basis, I would try to shift away from that, at least as a test, and say, okay, I'm going to eliminate a lot of my dairy for the next week to 10 days, and then I'll test it and have some and see if that makes a difference in how my joints feel. Certainly processed meats, all the chemicals used in that processing, also inflammatory as a rule. Sweetened, caffeinated drinks, try to reduce those. Certainly the snacks that we also are easy to pick up, try to pick up those fruits and veggies instead. All of those things promote inflammation. And if you have an arthritic joint, that's where it's going to go to. That change in your dietary chemistry is going to influence that arthritic joint, no question. You have some control, you do. Eat well, move well, think well. Use those resources available to you. You can control some of that inflammatory patterning. I hope just understanding some of the basic anatomy and that process of arthritis helps you to make those choices more effectively, because now I get it. That's what's happening at this joint that gives me so much trouble. I should be supporting it. If it says it's tired and sore, it probably needs a break. It may need a rest. I may need to ice it. And certainly watching what you eat is going to influence it. Thanks for joining me. Okay. Questions?
I have a question.
Yes.
Okay, you go into Walgreens and you see aisles and aisles of glucosamine, and you can probably name 10 more. Are those any good?
I think there's some value in the joint complex formulas. Again, you get what you pay for. Again, glucosamine is a precursor, a building block for cartilage. So if you're not getting that from other dietary sources, that's worth getting as a supplement. Again, I'm gonna give you this handout. I think it has info, and I should say, this is from Dr. Greg Bonikowski has recently joined our practice, and his kind of specialty is in nutritional influences on disease. So this is specific on the whole grain idea, but he also has spoken about other nutritionals. And the big ones, anti-inflammatory vitamins and nutrients, the ones I'm always going to promote, probably to just about every patient that comes through, is fish oil, omega-3 fatty acids, vitamin D, very easy to get, very inexpensive,
D3.
And for those of us living in the northern hemisphere, you can mega dose on those. I will give people 5,000 IUs a day throughout the year. I don't think that's a risk at all. Vitamin C is good for, again, cartilage and connective tissue, and that's easy to get. So,
calcium?
Not necessarily.
They're promoting the calcium with D3
combo. And that has to, again, you need the D3 for calcium to be absorbed, but calcium, I think you can get very good calcium through your fruits and veggies if you're able to eat those things. So taking a calcium supplement, if that would be more specific to a certain person, not across the board.
My understanding of it with the glucosamine and the chondroitin, that it takes up to 6 months before you see any type of positive reaction. Is that so?
I would say minimum of 3 months I would give it, of a consistent use before you can make a judgment call. And unfortunately, with anything nutritional, then the question goes back to, how well is your body able to break down those foods and use them? So if you're dealing with GI issues, nausea, irritable bowel, those kind of things, unfortunately, you're having a hard time breaking down foods and using those nutrients. So again, is it helpful to mega dose on some of those things so you have those particles available? Yes, maybe. Again, every person's different, and that's where I see, some value in doing a consult with someone who's a little more knowledgeable in the nutritional background and how your specific health situation is going to influence your ability to use those nutrients.
And on some medications, you shouldn't be eating some.
Yes, and that's the challenge for many people they're facing. You're being given a bit of a restrictive diet because of the medications you're on for other reasons. So you do the best you can with where you are.
Often you hear of, I just talked to this woman, she had her knee replaced 3 times now. And now she's working on doing something with her back, I guess. I don't know. And I think, it just seems like if you've got a bad knee, it's going to go through your system.
It's going to influence the next joint up. That's a shame that it's had to be replaced 3 times. There's other issues.
Well, she said it started out 20 years ago, and they're only supposed to last 10 years.
Granted. And again, I would like to believe, those surgical options are getting better. They're making better choices about what style of implant to use, and the materials used is better, et cetera, et cetera. But again, the real key then is friends and family who are showing early signs of this, to take care of the things you can control early on, and hopefully don't get to that point. But indeed, once you start the surgical intervention, very often it's the first step in a long road of surgical interventions.
What do you think about jogging? after 50 or...
Yeah, I really don't see the point. And granted, again, and I'm not much of a runner myself, so you would get a different response from those who enjoy running and such, but I really think, yeah, these joints, hips and knees and ankles, really have a tough time taking that impact, and you're asking for that injury-related arthritis to develop. Again, someone who has done it very consistently their whole life, you know, has not had a real severe injury, their cartilage probably is still holding up pretty good.
And they're usually slim, very slim.
Granted, exactly, and that's a factor, but again, I'm inclined to say, let's do walking, let's do biking, let's do swimming. Certainly move that joint, but let's not impact it quite so hard.
Jog in the pool if you want to jog.
Yes, yes. Good option. Okay, so I will see, hopefully, some of these faces back in September. When I'm back, we'll think about sciatica.